Hi everyone, welcome back to Machine Learning and Causal Inference. The overarching pitch of this class so far has been something like this. We need to understand causal effects in order to do good data-driven decision-making. Causal effects are out there. They're defined in terms of potential outcomes. They exist before you collect any data, and they certainly exist before you even think about applying any method to the data. So if we talk about machine learning and causal inference, we talk about causal effects as kind of these fundamental objects that are in nature, and machine learning as a set of tools that helps you better understand and estimate these causal effects. In particular, machine learning provides a set of tools that are helpful whenever you have large or particularly complicated data sets you want to use in understanding causal effects. So this is a story we've talked about quite a bit so far. And in doing so, we've really focused on the causal inference side of the story and tried to build some bridges from causal inference towards machine learning. One part of the story we focused a little less on is the machine learning side of things, and kind of what is machine learning really? One thing to note is that by now in social sciences, most people have had some exposure to machine learning, but mostly to a very narrow slice of machine learning involving prediction problems. A lot of people will think of machine learning essentially as the thing you go to when you're looking at when you have a large database of images of cats and dogs, and you want to use these images to train an algorithm that can distinguish cats and dogs in a way that can generalize to new unseen data. And if that's your task, then machine learning is the place you go looking for methods for it. But if you talk to engineers, they might tell you that this is actually a fairly narrow view of what machine learning is. There's a huge number of tasks out there that fit under the general umbrella of machine learning, and prediction task is just, it's a very nice and kind of very high impact area of machine learning, but it's still a pretty small slice of the pie. Trying to give a general definition of machine learning, like for any area, is a delicate thing. But if you wanted to attempt to do so, some ingredients you'd certainly need is that a machine learning problem involves a task, something you're trying to do. It involves a loss function, something that rewards you or punishes you for performing the task well or poorly. And then it involves data that you can use to learn an algorithm that can perform the task well according to the loss function. So if you think about your image classification task, distinguishing cats from dogs, it clearly fits under this perspective. The task is recognizing cats and dogs. Your loss is one if you get the classification wrong, and zero if you get it correctly. And then you just want to use these images to learn to classify accurately. It fits kind of obviously under this umbrella. But another completely different task that still fits under this umbrella could be flying a helicopter. Your task is to keep the helicopter up in the air. Your loss function is zero as long as you're in the air. It's one if you crash. And your task, well, it's to fly the helicopter while maintaining a low loss, that is while staying in the air. What's the data you want to use? Well, here it could depend. You could have access to videos of professional pilots flying helicopters, or you could give your algorithm access to a flight simulator where they can try different flight strategies and see what works and what doesn't. And again, this might look completely different from a prediction problem, but if you talk to engineers, this is certainly something that would fall under the umbrella of machine learning. And it's also certainly a problem that involves a well-defined task, a well-defined loss function, and using data to optimize that loss. So anyways, what I want to do in this week's lecture is to build on our earlier discussions of treatment effect estimation and more formally connect them to this loss-based view of machine learning, and essentially to show how you can turn our discussions about treatment effect estimation so far into loss functions that capture these treatment effects. So then when you try to train a machine learning method against these loss functions, they give you treatment effect estimates as a byproduct, and you get what you want kind of in a fully general machine learning setting. Before talking about how to design loss functions for treatment effect estimations and all the nuances that'll entail, I first want to kind of, as a warm-up and review, talk briefly about what this loss-based view of machine learning looks like in some simpler, familiar settings, so then we can see how to extrapolate from there. So again, the simplest machine learning problem, of course, is prediction. So we have data, X's and Y's. We want to predict Y from X. And formally, we want to design a predictor. We want to learn a predictor mu hat that takes as input your X's and outputs predictions for Y. And given a predictor, what's your loss function? Well, a predictor takes as input an X, outputs a prediction mu of X, and your loss there is L of mu of X comma Y. It's the prediction error Y minus mu of X squared. Where do we go from here? Well, for any given predictor mu hat, your training loss is a sum over your n training examples of this squared error loss. In general, to learn mu hat, you're going to minimize the squared error loss with some amount of regularization. And then what is the criterion you care about? The end. You hope that this mu hat you learned on the training set is going to, when deployed on the test set, make predictions mu hat of xi for unseen examples yi that get log squared error loss. So really what I'm emphasizing here is that kind of everything in prediction goes through the squared error loss function. Once you're given this loss function, everything becomes more algorithmic procedural. You have a training set, you have a test set, you have a training phase, you have regularization, but the loss function is there at the center of every task. So kind of more specifically, if you want to train a predictor, you're gonna be given a training set, and on that training set, you're usually gonna run some algorithm. This could be the last, so it could be boosting, it could be deep neural networks. These methods for actually learning a predictor kind of algorithmically look pretty different, but fundamentally all they're trying to do is minimize the training error loss, the squared error loss function you have here, using different functional forms and different types of regularizations in the hope that getting a low training loss in terms of squared error on the training set will then generalize into a low test loss on a test set. So this loss function is used in training. If you want to measure the accuracy of your model and kind of predict test set performance, you can use cross-validation, which is essentially just involves considering the squared error loss out of fold in your training set. Or if you want to do combine different models, I'm going to talk about stacking later in this lecture. And then you can use stacking as a tool for model averaging. That's also going to be governed by squared error loss. So again, once you have the squared error loss function, everything else is just defined in terms of it. So to kind of understand the power of this idea, let's talk about a different setting where we also might want to do machine learning, but it's not a prediction problem. And here, one nice problem that's less often talked about, but where everything works out nicely, is the following problem in inventory management. It's called the news vendor model because you can kind of think of the problem as motivated by the following story. You're running a newsstand, and you need to choose how many newspapers Q you're going to purchase before the start of the day. If you purchase too few newspapers, you're at risk of stocking out, which means you'll lose sales due to that. But if you purchase too many newspapers, then you have a high risk of having newspapers left over at the end of the day. And of course, no one wants yesterday's newspapers, so that's going to be pure waste. So you'd want to pick, order a quantity of newspaper Q that's not too high and not too low. And then kind of for any specific quantity, what's your profit going to be? Well, you need to first purchase your Q newspapers. You're going to purchase them at cost C. So you're going to pay CQ. Then what's your revenue going to be? Well, the number of newspapers you sell is the minimum of demand and the number of newspapers you had in stock. So it's going to be the minimum of D and Q, where D stands in for demand. And then you're going to sell them at price P. Your profit is just going to be the difference between these two terms, that is revenue and costs. So far, so good. Now let's say you're kind of a fancy news vendor and you recognize that different days are different. For example, maybe after a major sporting event, you might expect to sell more newspapers and you want to take that into account. So now what you're going to do is you're also going to measure some covariate X that help you predict days or kind of anticipate days when you should purchase more or less newspapers. And then what you're after is a policy, is a stocking policy pi of X, where kind of on different days, depending on the covariates X, you'll purchase a different number of newspapers, Q equals pi of X. So if you were to deploy this policy, what's your expected profit gonna be? Well, it's just gonna be the expected profit from above, except now I'm just gonna specifically write Q as pi of X. So the value of your policy pi, say that's the expected profit, it's just gonna be P, the price at which you're selling newspapers, times the minimum of DM pi of X minus your average cost, that is the expectation of C times pi of X. So far, I've just been talking about definitions, that is, given a policy, what is your expected profit from deploying that policy in this news vendor model. But now, of course, the question is, how could you actually come up with a good policy? And in particular, how can you use data to figure out a good policy pi? And I hope I've kind of suggested the solution strongly enough that at this point, it shouldn't be a surprise. Essentially, there's a task. You need to choose how many newspapers to purchase. And there's a reward function V of X, that's your expected profit. Your loss function is gonna be the negative profit. And you'd want to kind of think of this as a machine learning task where you want to use covariates to choose how much to order, such as to maximize your profit or minimize your loss, the negative of the profit. And once you adopt this perspective, kind of what to do next is very clear. For example, if you think about regression trees as trees that kind of try to minimize squared error loss, well, what would be a tree-based algorithm for optimal inventory management? You could perfectly well imagine training a tree by recursive partitioning, as we usually do, except now your loss function for training the tree isn't squared error loss. Your loss function for training a tree is negative profit, and you kind of take it from there. If you want to read more about this here too, recent papers that go into that. But anyways, the point here is that if we want to deploy machine learning for inventory management, essentially you need to remember what the news vendor problem is about. You need to remember what kind of stocking quantity, demand, cost, price are. But once you've done so, then you can kind of codify all that subject matter knowledge into a loss function. And then when you actually start deploying this, your kind of the part where you do machine learning looks exactly the same as for prediction. You're trying to kind of using an algorithm, minimize your training loss over a regularized class of functions, say trees, or it could be deep nets also. And where do we go from here? Well, your tree is gonna try to minimize in-sample loss on the training set. You could use this loss function ln here for cross-validation. You could kind of cut your training set in folds and always kind of on some of the folds, train a tree that kind of prescribes stocking quantities. And on the held out fold, you could try to see how well you did. When you want to kind of see at the very end how well you did, well, then you'd kind of want to deploy your method on a test set and assess test set loss for your stocking policy. But the point I'm making is that kind of once we found a loss function that captures what's important about inventory management, then the problem of deploying machine learning for inventory management is kind of algorithmically verbatim to what we did before, with the only difference is that you swapped in a different loss function. So with that background, today, with this week's lecture is about is loss functions for causal problems. So there are going to be three parts today. The first part is going to be on loss functions for treatment heterogeneity. So specifically, I'm going to continue last week's discussion about causal forests, which essentially were kind of more of an ad hoc forest-based algorithm for estimating heterogeneous treatment effects in a way that was robust in observational studies. And the goal today is going to be to kind of extract the key parts of the algorithm that made causal forest work, and then distill those into a loss function that you can use with any machine learning method. So the main difference relative to what I showed you earlier with prediction or inventory management is that unlike in those cases, there isn't going to be quite as obvious a loss function to use in this context. So we're gonna have to work a little bit harder to design a good loss function. So that's part one. Part two is gonna be on interpreting and validating estimates of the conditional average treatment effect. Essentially by now, we've talked a lot about how to estimate KATES accurately. I want to say a little bit more about what you might want to do once you actually estimated KATES and want to see how well did you do? What have you learned? So that's part two. And then in the last part today, I'm gonna talk about policy learning. And by policy learning, I mean the problem of learning decision rules that try to exploit causal effects. The problem of learning treatment policies is very closely related to the problem of estimating heterogeneous treatment effects, but it's slightly different. When we're estimating heterogeneous treatment effects, we're trying to give a numeric answer. Kind of for a given person, we might ask, is the treatment effect 0.1? Is it 0.3? And we try to tune that under kind of squared error loss on the KATE scale. On the other hand, if we're talking about learning treatment assignment policies, then our decision is going to be more like a classification decision. It's going to be a 0 or a 1, treat, don't treat. And this is going to lead to some subtle differences. So I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about the problem of policy learning, and then I'm going to talk about how to design loss functions for that task also.